The French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.
To every schoolboy, chestnuts are currency. Like marbles or baseball cards, you can trade them. Or you can make bubble pipes out of them. And they're wonderful to throw. But wait till you see what we're going to do with chestnuts today on the French Chef. Welcome to the French Chef. I'm Julia Child. Today we're going to do a show on chestnuts. I think it's an awfully good idea to do one because they're so good to eat and you can do so many different kinds of things with them. And a lot of us sort of are confused by chestnuts and don't really quite know how they can be used. Of course, 40 years ago, the country abounded in chestnut trees and everybody knew everything about them. But then a great blight came along and wiped every chestnut tree off the face of the nation. Of course, we still have horse chestnuts, but they're not edible. Even horses don't eat them. And our edible chestnuts come from Europe, mostly from Italy. And when they come, you find them in the market very often in a sack like that, or else just whole and loose. And when you buy fresh chestnuts, you want to be sure that they're nice and heavy when you feel them, and that also that the nut and the skin are really tightly close together, and that shows that they're really fresh. And you can buy either fresh chestnuts or canned chestnuts, and we're going to start out with the fresh ones. And fresh chestnuts, of course, when they grow on the tree, they have a big sort of nubbly green skin on them, and when the frost comes, the skin cracks, and then the nut falls to the ground. And there it is, and it has an outer shell, and then it has an inner skin. And they're both of them are very close fitting. You see, there's that sort of brown inner skin, and then this is the white part of the nut. And before you're going to eat chestnuts, and before you're going to use them, you have to peel them, and then you have to cook them. And there are, a good dozen ways of peeling chestnuts. I've tried all of them, and I'm going to do the one that I like the best. And in that one, you take your whole chestnut, and as you notice, there's a little flat side usually, and then the rounded side. And you take a sharp little knife, and you just peel a strip of the outside shell off of each chestnut. That one already has been peeled, and that one's fairly round. But you have to make a little hole in it, like that. I'll do one more. And that's fairly quickly done. And then you take all of your chestnuts that you have peeled this little strip off, and you drop them in a pan of cold water, and then you bring the water up to the boil, and you let it boil for 1 minute. And then, after it's boiled for 1 minute, you take it off the heat, and then you take a slotted spoon and you lift them out, three at a time, and both the outer shell and the inner skin should come off, and you just take them with a knife and just peel them like that. And you have to do it when the chestnuts are warm. You suddenly have a whole bunch of chestnuts to do and you've peeled half of them and then you have to go out and do something else. And the water cools off, then you find you can't peel them. As you say, this way, the skin and the shell both come off. And if you're doing a whole bunch of them, there once in a while you come to a non-peeler and set all your non-peelers aside and drop them in boiling water and let them sit for about a minute, and then you can peel the skin off. And it's quite a chore to peel them, but if you have three or four people and you're all sitting around watching the TV, educational TV, it's a great deal of fun. And it's sort of a nice communal activity. And then after you have them all peeled, you have to cook them. And to do that, you put them in a pan. And I found, too, that after you've peel them, you don't want to set them aside covered, because sometimes they can become a little, moldy. So you really should peel them and cook them about at the same day, or if you have peeled them ahead of time, don't cover them in their bowl. Then you put them in your pan, and then you cover them with a meat stock or chicken stock. I'm using a beef bouillon there, and then some water. And you want to be sure that the liquid covers them by thoroughly, because they won't cook if the liquid doesn't cover them completely. And then you're going to flavor it with some celery. It always goes well with celery. There's a nice limp piece that is good for better for cooking than for eating. And we want some parsley, and we want a bay leaf. And then we want some thyme. And this is some fresh thyme that somebody grew in their garden and sent to me. You just grow it in the summertime and then hang it up in the attic and let it dry. And if you have whole thyme like this, you just wrap it up in with your celery and parsley and bend it around and then tie it up with white string. And if you don't have whole thyme, if you just have dried bottle thyme, then make your herb bouquet and tie it up in wet cheesecloth. And the reason you tie it up is that so you can remove it, and you don't want a lot of loose herbs floating around in your stock. There. And then you bring that up to the simmer and then let it cook very, very slowly for about 35 to 40 minutes. We want the chestnuts to remain whole if you're going to use them for a stuffing, or if you're going to use them as a whole vegetable, and they're very attractive when they're done that way. And about 35 to 40 minutes of a very slow simmer, if it really boils hard, then the chestnuts will separate, and we want them to keep as whole as possible. And then after 35 to 40 minutes, you have your cooked chestnuts. And the best way to tell when they're cooked is just to eat one. And they should be so that when you eat it tastes like a cooked chestnut, and it isn't hard. And when you've finished that, you can let your chestnuts sit in your stock for, oh heavens, for a day or two in the refrigerator. And then, here are some canned chestnuts. I brought these out because I thought you'd like to see them. I have frankly never used canned chestnuts until I was getting ready to show you about chestnuts. And I'm sort of a do-it-yourself type, and I've always thought, oh, they'd be really not very good. I find they're simply delicious. And the canned chestnut here that you buy has come up to exactly the same stage as the chestnut that you would cook yourself. It doesn't have quite the same texture and flavor, and it's when you buy them, it says canned whole chestnuts for stuffing, and it's just chestnuts and water. And if you want to give them some flavor, if you're going to use them for a vegetable, you would then heat them, pour them into a pan and bring them just up to the simmer, and then drain out the liquid, which you can save for something else, and then put in some stock and seasonings just the way we have with these. Bring that up for the simmer for about 3 or 4 minutes, and then let them steep for half an hour. And you want to give them some kind of a flavor, otherwise they're not very interesting. And 35 to 40 whole chestnuts will give you about 2.5 cups of peeled chestnuts and 6 to 8 cups of chestnuts are about enough for if you're going to make a chestnut puree. And so now that we have both our cooked and our canned chestnuts, I'm going to show you what you can do with them. And one of the very nice things to do with whole chestnuts is to glaze them. And for that, you take some of the stock that you've cooked them with and mix it with a little bit of cornstarch and a little bit of port wine, and then put it in a little pan. I'm just going to do a very few of them just so you can see how it is. And then you let that come up to the simmer, and then you put some of your chestnuts in. Now, I've got a slotted spoon somewhere. Oh, I've got another one. Oh, there's my slotted spoon. And then you put some of your ready-cooked chestnuts in there. And These should all, of course, be whole. Some of these aren't, but it really doesn't make too much difference. And then you just shake that around over heat until your glaze has melted down and covered your chestnuts. And then you just put them in a little dish or along with any other kind of vegetables that you would like, such as onions and carrots. And that makes an extremely nice vegetable and a very pretty one, and also very good to eat. And then we have our classic chestnut puree, which is something that we always have for, you always have with goose or turkey, if you get around to making it. But it's awfully good, and particularly with your canned chestnuts, it's extremely easy to make. Now here, a puree just means that you've sieved things. And this is a food mill, and this is a particularly nice one, which I thought you would like to see. It comes with three blades. There's a coarse blade, and there's a very fine blade. And then this is the medium blade, which we're going to use. A lot of these don't have various blades, and but I think the one that has the interchangeable one is extremely useful. And you fit the blade in, and then you put in this whizzer thing that forces everything through. Then here's our, there's our herb bouquet, which we can now get rid of. And then you pour the whole business into your food mill, letting it drain, and then pour the liquid back into the pan, and then you just start to push them through. You notice on this food mill it has these little feet, which are very, which is a new invention, a new innovation. This is the new model. And then you just push them right through. And if you're going to puree canned chestnuts, you have to be sure to heat them through until it's just up to the, until they come up to the simmer, and let them simmer for a moment or two so that you can puree them. Otherwise, they'd be a little too hard to get through the food mill. Now, chestnuts are really quite a dry kind of a thing, so you've got to flavor it up with cream or butter. You notice all of the puree down there, so you always scrape that off. And then you have your puree, so you want to flavor that up. You put in a little bit of the stock in which you cooked it. You know, in France, chestnuts have been eaten for thousands of years. And before they had potatoes, they used chestnuts instead of potatoes. Then you put in a little bit of softened butter, and then salt and pepper to taste. And you can get the chestnuts done way ahead of time, as long as when they're done, you don't cover them until they're absolutely cold. And then to reheat them again, you would set your bowl or saucepan over simmering water and then stir them up every once in a while until they were nicely heated through, and then you might want to beat in a little more salt and pepper. So that's all there is to making a very good chestnut puree, which you would serve with goose or turkey. Or it goes awfully nicely with pork, too. And now we're going to get to our chestnut dessert. And this one, I'm going to use canned chestnuts. That's because I want to show you how you can make a very quick and very elegant dessert in no time at all. And with these, with the canned chestnuts, of course, they haven't had any other flavoring with them at all. And so you want to flavor them with some sugar. But you don't want the sugar to be granulated, so that you melt some sugar in a little pan with either some water or some port wine. And I'm going to use 5.5 cups of chestnuts. That would be 2 cans. And so I'm going to use 1/2 cup of sugar and about 4 or 5 tablespoons of port wine. And then we have our chestnut puree over here. And that's 5.5 cups or two of these large cans. And then I'm going to put some chocolate in it. That's 8 ounces of melted chocolate. When you think of that, chestnuts are really just sort of a nut or a flour. They need quite a bit of flavoring when you're going to use them for something like a dessert. That's 8 ounces of melted chocolate. And then I'm going to start whizzing them around. You can do all of this by hand, of course. And then we're going to put some butter in, because this is going to be a molded dessert. And the butter, and both the butter and the chocolate will, when it gets into the refrigerator, will, you know, congeal and hold the dessert up. And you'll find, too, with the chestnuts, because they're rather dry, that you want quite a bit of butter. And it's also a heavy dessert, so don't be shocked at this amount of butter, because this is going to serve about 10 or 12 people. I've got about 1/2 pound in there. And I'm going to go back and look at my sugar and see how that is. Now that's all melted, so that can go right in at the same time. Now if you're going to do fresh chestnuts, this way you would simmer your peeled chestnuts in a sugar syrup. You'd use about a cup of sugar to each quart of water. And then you put in a vanilla bean. Now, I have to put that down a little bit. Now that's mixed up nicely enough. And now we're going to flavor it. And it really needs a little bit of wine flavoring, at least if you're going to be French. You can put in rum or kirsch. I'm going to put in some rum. And I think I'm going to put in about 4 tablespoons of rum, and then taste it and see how it is. And I've got to put in a little vanilla too, because everything's supposed to have vanilla in it, and I'll put in 1 tablespoon of vanilla. Now we'll just taste it and see if it needs any more wine in it. If you don't like actual wine or liquor, you can always use imitation rum flavoring. That's pretty good. I think it needs just a little tiny bit of salt. It's interesting how many times sweet things do need a little salt. It sort of brings out more of their character. I put in just about 1/4 teaspoon there. Now that's mixed up well enough. Of course, you don't have to do this in a mixer at all. You can just mix it all in by hand. Oh, there, I'll put that there, and we'll take this off and then give it some final tasting and see how it is. You see how very quick that is to make. And now, what we're going to do with this, we're going to make what is called a palissade. Oh, marron. The French word for chestnut is marron. And this is going to be a dessert molded in cookies. And you can make it in one of these rather high-sided molds. This is a Charlotte mold, which the French use such a great deal. The sides are about 3.5 inches high. And if you're going to do that, you have to have some cookies that are going to be exactly the same shape, because we're same length, because we're going to cut cookies all around the side there. And the classical French cookie would be these little langues de chat, or cat's tongues. And these are made just out of egg whites and sugar and butter. And then you would arrange them all the way around like that. But that also takes quite a bit of extra time. And if you're in a hurry, you can just go out and buy some nice cookies. This, and you can use just an ordinary low-sided dish. This is just a souffle mold. And the ideal cookie, I didn't find the ideal one, would be this very little thin sugar cookie, which would fit just about like that in the mold. I didn't find that kind, so I got this kind, which is a double cookie, and it has a little chocolate on the inside. But that's going to be very nice, too. So I'll use that. And then you have your mold, and then you cut a piece of wax paper just the same size as the bottom of the mold. And then you put in a little bit of your chocolate mixture, chocolate and chestnut, and that is so that you want to have a sort of a foundation so that this will hold up the cookies when we put them around. And then, you see, we have this lining of our chestnut mixture, and then you just stick the cookies in all around. I've got another dessert already made, and you're going to see how nice this is. Well, I think those cookies are really rather nice, and having extra chocolate never hurts anything if you like chocolate the way I do. And then you just simply fill the rest of your mold with your chestnut mixture. You really wouldn't ever know that was a chestnut mixture. I suppose this was invented by the French just because they had so many chestnuts and didn't know what to do with them. Then you have your mold all filled, and you should cover it with waxed paper and a rubber band, and then put it in the refrigerator. And that you should finish this probably 6 or 7 hours ahead of time, because you really have to give it time for the chocolate and the butter to set. So otherwise, if you unmolded it before it was set, it would just be sort of this wet mixture that you now see. So we'll put that in the refrigerator, and then I'll take out one that I have already made. I made this one in the high-sided Charlotte mold with those little cat's tongues, so that you could sort of get an idea of how glorious it can be if you have one of these great big, if you have one of these high molds. And now this, you think, oh dear, this is never going to unmold. But it does, as you will see. Now you take a knife and you go all the way around the edge. Be sure that you get all the way around the outside. It's just sort of cutting it in like that. I can already feel it beginning to budge just a little bit, so I'm quite sure it's going to unmold nicely. Then, of course, the paper on the bottom is not buttered, and you want to be sure that it isn't buttered. And I can see that's budging very nicely, so it's going to unmold well. Then you put your dish on upside down and just turn it over and center it nicely. There we are. There we are. Now, see, those were made with these little cat's tongues. And I think it really looks very nicely indeed. And then this, as I said, this is a heavy dessert. It's really sort of like a candy cake. So that this is a 6-cup mold, and I think this would probably very nicely serve 10 people, because you just want to give them a very small amount of it. And then, because it's dry and heavy, you want also to have some kind of a sauce to go with it. I would serve either a very lightly whipped cream or else one of those English custard sauces that would be either flavored with a little bit of rum or with vanilla. And then you have a perfectly delicious dessert. Now, another thing that you can do with this very same mixture would be you put it into the refrigerator until it has become fairly nicely sort of congealed so that you can work it around, and then you can roll it out with your hands until you make a little sort of nice little candy ball. And then you can roll that in chocolate shot and put it in a little paper cup, and you have a perfectly delicious little homemade candy. So you really have quite a few things that you can do with this. So now I think I shall take this into the dining room and we will see what we have accomplished. Now let's take a look at what we've done with all these chestnuts. Here are our glazed chestnuts, and they're surrounded in a very beautiful way by a spoke of braised carrots. and little glazed onions, and that makes a very attractive vegetable dish to serve along with your goose or your turkey, or it goes very nicely with duck or with pork. And then here is our classic chestnut puree, and this you use instead of mashed potatoes, and you'd serve that also with goose or turkey or duck. And then I want to talk a little bit more about the canned chestnut business. Canned chestnuts, as you've seen, are really a great blessing, though an expensive one. One can, which weighs about 1 pound 5 ounces, they're all put up in France, and that costs about $1.50. And then a little bag of fresh chestnuts costs about 39 or 40 cents, so it's about canned chestnuts are about 3 times more expensive. But for a party, or when you want to be fancy and you don't have a great deal of time, they're just canned chestnuts are just wonderful to have on hand. But remember, when you use them, that you have to flavor them up with something else. As I mentioned, if you're going to use them as canned whole chestnuts for a vegetable, you would heat them in a pan and then pour off their liquid and then pour in some meat stock and herbs and let it simmer for about 5 minutes and then let them sit and absorb the flavor. And then you will have extremely good whole chestnuts as a garniture. Or if you wanted to use the whole chestnuts in the stuffing of a goose or a turkey, you would then drain them after they had soaked up all the flavor and let them cool. And then you would stuff them in your goose or your turkey and accompany them with, put in some brown sausages, or you could put in prunes, or you could put in apples, or if you're feeling very flush, you could even put in some truffles. But that makes an extremely good stuffing. And now we will get to our dessert, our palissade de marron, or chestnut palissade. And I think I will carve you a piece so you can see how it looks on the plate. And these cookies, of course, which are crisp little cookies when they start out, are after they've sat with the chestnuts and the chocolate in the refrigerator, they soften up so that you can cut them nicely. So there you have something that looks just like a cake. And because you do need some kind of a sauce with it, we're going to just serve a little lightly whipped cream that's been with some a little bit of sugar folded into it and some rum. And that makes a perfectly delicious dessert, which I think you will enjoy very much. And so, remember what you can do with chestnuts. These are only 3 recipes, but they're all extremely good ones. And you can use either the fresh chestnuts, which are certainly something to peel, but it's well worth it. So there we have 3 happy endings to a 1.5-hour show. So give the old chestnut a try. That's all for today on The French Chef. This is Julia Child. Bon appétit and enjoy cooking chestnuts.
Julia Child is co-author of the book Mastering the Art of French Cooking.
French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.